I'm going to speak about an important topic and also exertion, limb length. We're going to go through history, evolution, complications, and current concepts. It starts with Cody Verga from Italy, who started doing bone lengthening through skeletal traction, doing an osteotomy and skeletal traction. Then out, started to use unilateral fixator. Their breakthrough of bone lengthening was with the advent of Elizalde fixator or Elizalde external fixator. My history with Elizalde started in 1983, where Professor Gamal Kazim, he was the chairman of the Orthopedic Department at Benha University Hospital, brought Elizalde external fixator from Russia to Egypt, and we've been using it at the time, which is about 37 years ago when I was a resident, and we started to do many cases of trauma, bone lengthening, bone transport since that date. So our experience with Elizalde started 37 years ago. This presentation is based on my 37 years experience. I was doing thousands of cases by external fixation. More lengthening for cosmetic lengthening, more lengthening in congenital deformities, post-traumatic deformities, poliomyelitis, and other indications. You will find all that in my paper presented in the Journal of Orthopedics and Traumatology 2020 this year, which was published about 1 month ago. Egyptian history, you know, Egyptians have long history. And in this history, there was description of the short people and dwarfs, and they have special positions in Egyptian history. So many of the divine protectors in their pantheon were deformed, best and protector of the Nile, happy. Society's attitude to the deformity and society's attitude to the short stature and dwarfism, there was no discrimination. Thousands of years ago, Egyptians were treating the dwarfs and short people normally. You see in this picture, taken during dancing in the temples, all the dancers were tall, except one of them, very short for dwarf. Slim, he was very important man, very rich man in the pharaonic time, and he had many important positions. He was married to a normal length, a tall girl, and he had children, normal children. The ordinary people, or chondroplastic people at the time, were doing normal jobs. Butchers, musicians, as you see here. They were not treated as different people. They were treated normally. What's the aim of limb lengthening? It's a correction of the limb length inequality. If we have shortening for one limb, if we have less than two centimeters, usually we do nothing. From 2 to 4, this is the gray centimeter, this is the gray zone. Perhaps we can lengthen the patient. But after 4 centimeters, usually we have problems, functional problems, and we have to do limb lengthening. Also, we are seeking for functional improvement in such cases. The third indication is cosmetic lengthening. We do cosmetic lengthening. We don't differentiate between cosmetic lengthening and lengthening for other patients. Because some people are really short and they need to have lengthening. And if you look at this picture, this patient with severe shortening of the left leg and deformity and the full rotation, the heel in front and the forefoot behind. So you have severe deformity, severe shortening. It's about 12 centimeters shortening in this child. What we do lengthening, as you see here, and we correct the limb length discrepancy gradually. Then we derotate the foot. It looks like derotation or lengthening by derotation to correct the deformity. So, in such a case, the aim of bone lengthening is not just correction of the deformity or correction of the shortening. Actually, it's changing life. In this picture again, with radial club hand, we lengthened the forearm of the patient about 115% of the original length. This is changing lives. Again, this patient was traumatic, crushed amputation of the foot, which had been treated by shortening and replantation, and you had 22 centimeters shortening. We lengthened for 22 centimeters, about more than 100% of the original length. It's actually changing lives. The biology of limb lengthening, the general biological law of tension stress. All the biology, the recent limb lengthening, are based on LSR's biological law of tension stress. Whatever you do, whatever the instrument you use, whatever you use, X-fix, you use computer assisted. External fixator, unilateral fixator, lengthening nails, whatever the instrument you use, all are based on the law of tension stress, which is the biological law invented by Elizabeth. What's the law of tension stress? Gradual traction on living tissues creates stresses that can stimulate and maintain the regeneration of active growth of certain tissues. So when adequate blood supply, steady gradual traction of the tissues activates proliferative and biosynthetic functions. The regeneration develops along the axis of the applied traction. So the regenerate is develops along the axis of the applied traction. Corticotomy. There's arguments whether to do corticotomy or osteotomy. We are not going through this argument, but usually we do corticotomy. Experimental studies reveal the importance of soft tissue preservation during corticotomy and fixated stability. And the osteogenic power in the regeneration area depends upon the degree of bone marrow damage, periosteum, and the nutrient vessels. We always do corticotomy from a small incision, and then we go through the medial cortex and lateral cortex, and we do derotation of the fragments to get closed corticotomy posteriorly. So we keep the blood supply, we keep the soft tissues. And this is the real merit of the advances of bone lengthening, the biology, not the instrument we use. We have three stages of the biology, three stages of bone lengthening. First, the latency phase. After corticotomy, we wait for about 5 to 10 days. Why? Because we want to do healing of the soft tissue. Then distraction, or gradual distraction. The distraction is the rate 1 millimeter per day, in general. But we increase the rate or decrease the rate according to the regenerative function. If you have good regenerative continuum, such as we have profuse regenerative, we increase the rate. If you have the regenerative is poor, we decrease the rate of distraction. If it is very poor, sometimes you do compression, then distraction many times. The third one is consolidation. After we reach the target, our target, we wait for the consolidation phase where the bone takes the normal shape of the bone. So we have three stages of the biology of bone lengthening: latency phase, distraction phase, and consolidation phase. There are many methods for the development nowadays to stimulate the regenerative. Regeneration area, whether we have systemic or local. Systemic like bisphosphonates, local like bone morphogenic protein, platelet-rich plasma, still under trials. Because the dream of all orthopedic surgeons, that we finish for all the patients, that we finish lengthening in a very short time. We know that lengthening takes about one centimeter takes about 1 month. We want to decrease it, so it's still under trial, many methods. The evolution of our lengthening device. Every day we have a new device. The merit of the device is well known, but they all use the same biological or the law of tangency. Started with the skeletal traction. The new reactor fixator was the standard fixator for such a long, long time. Then the reserve center fixator using the reserve method. Then computer assisted. External fixators, TSF, or tailor special frame, X-up holder, SUV. Then internal momentum needs, which made a difference. Because some people, they don't like to have an external fixation of something outside the skin. The albesia nail, ISKD, feet bone, and recently also precise. Also been using many techniques. Lengthening the nail. We do lengthening, and after we finish the distraction, we put a nail. But there are dangers because of the deep infection, and we had it before. So we don't advise lengthening over nails. Lengthening over elastic nails have been used too in children. Lengthening over some muscular plate or locking plate. Again, it's fraught with the complication of infection or reinfection, especially in the Middle East with the hot weather. Or lengthening, then plating afterwards. Finally, the internal lengthening devices. The mechanical, like adhesion air, developed by Pichet and ISPD. Then electrical, fitbone, developed by Baumgart. And finally, magnetic or precise air. The adhesion of rotation, you can get lengthening, then ISPD with its complications. Then it was withdrawn from the market. Finally, we have the fitbone with rate, rhythm, duration of the structure, controlled by radio frequency transmitter and implanted. The indications for limb lengthening. The indications are controversial. You have limb lengthening screens. If you have shortening of one limb, trauma, congenital deformities, whatever it is, dwarfs, like achondroplasia, have lengthening on both sides, and cosmetic, you have lengthening on both sides. The indications of nails, because many people are asking for nails, you have to know that lower limb deficiency in adolescents and adults, which distance? Because usually on nails we cannot lengthen for such a long distance, like 22 centimeters or 23 centimeters, usually between 5 and 8 centimeters. But the diameter of the bone, so it has to be not very thin, but the smallest diameter of the size is 8.5. You have to take care of the infection again. Maybe it's a remote complication, but if it happens, it's a real problem. And this is an example of unilateral lengthening, because this is the case of fibular amelia, or congenital absence of the fibula with the absence of the lateral two rays of the foot, tibial shortening and angulation. Such a case, we do osteotomy or corticotomy in the apex, and we do lengthening and we correct the foot. Complications. Many people are frightened or scared because of the complication. I have a real problem. Because when I revised the literature, I found something which is quite interesting. People are publishing this complication, which is quite normal in the English literature. But when you see this table, some people are doing 32 operations along 3 years, and they're multiple authors. Another is doing 73 patients along 14 years. So each year, he was doing something like 5 cases per year or something like this. So every 2.5 months, he was doing one case. And they were reporting their results and complications. What type of experience is this? If you compare it to the arthroplasty, when they speak about the arthroplasty, maybe they put a limit, 50 arthroplasty surgeons per year for just a casual surgeon or something. How would you allow somebody who is doing two cases per year, so every 6 months, is doing one case of one Lengthening, to give us his experience? Very strange. And it was repeated in the literature. The second thing, you know, the external fixation and Lengthening, you have many, many indications. We're doing trauma, you have many cases of trauma. Or doing non-union, you have many cases of non-union. You have cosmetic Lengthening, hundreds of cases. We have congenital deformity, hundreds of cases. Osteotomatic deformities. Pelvic support osteotomy, for more than 140 cases. So how are the people are reporting here that they are doing two cases per year? So what type of experience it is? We can consider most of the papers are speaking about casual Lengthening surgeons. Casual Lengthening surgeons. Anyhow, the most common complication is pin track infection, who usually does not cause any problem. Poor regional formation, premature consolidation of the regenerate, or axial malalignment. And I will give an example of this case of non-union. And we've done corticotomy and the compression, then Lengthening. The first complication occurred in this man is 36 years old, he has premature consolidation of the regenerate because of the very good newborn formation. So what we do for premature consolidation, we don't take the patient to the operating theatre. We continue the distraction. We continue the distraction till the power or the power distraction overcome the Lengthening area. So distraction starts back again. And this is malalignment. The patient is very big, and with this distraction for such a long distance, we have this deformity, various deformity. What we do? We change the distractor and the hinges. Gradual 1 millimeter per day, we see we corrected the deformity. Again, we don't take the patient to the operating theater again. Just we change the frame. Again, another problem, the common problem, if you do Lengthening and tibial Lengthening, done thousands of cases of tibial Lengthening. Sometimes you have a problem with the common peroneal nerve. How would you manage? We develop this, we start with this technique. When you put tibiofibular wire, when you do the tibiofibular wire, we push it from the fibula to the tibia, then we push it more till we stop flush to the fibula. So if you come closer to the common peroneal nerve, we started to be away from the problem. Complications of mechanically driven nails. That's why you say, when you think about Lengthening nails, wait and wait and wait. Because for the ICD, the people described it in the beginning as a miraculous thing. Then, after a few years, you have numerous complications. Runaway nails, and it was withdrawn from the market after having numerous complications. Complications are also precise name. This slide, I took this slide from Professor Jihani from Canada. And you have to know there's a word of caution. Not all complications are the same. Not to compare ventral infection to deep infection, if you put a name inside. Not compared with discomfort from keeping the fixity for such a long time for the infection. So you have to take care. If you want to put nail inside, whatever the type of nail, Lengthening nail, Lengthening, plate after Lengthening, you have to take care of that deep infection. Deep infection in such cases is a very serious complication. Physiotherapy is very important. Many times you allow the patient to teach the patient to go, to walk, to go to the swimming, to work, to do everything, they're normal. Hospital states only one day or daycare operation. The patient usually, the little patient out at the hospital in the same day of the more lengthening or the day after, because we minimize the process. We want to do more lengthening for everybody. It's not an expensive operation like the people describe in the West. We don't think so. And because we do many cases, we don't think the patient has to pay all that amount. We don't think so. So we do as much as we can to minimize the costs. Now I want to speak about some indications, achondroplasia. There are cultural differences. Why we have many people with achondroplasia have lengthening, but not in the West, but in Germany? Because we have a real problem. We don't have facilities for the short people. That's why all of them, they seek lengthening. At which age? Now we developed from our experience that we're transverted. We started the first lengthening for the tibia at the age 5 or 6 centimeters. And also we tightened the lateral ligament. We corrected the deformity, we lengthened 5-6 meters, and we raised the tibia above the fibula because the fibula is high. So we tensioned the lateral ligament. Then we do femoral lengthening at the age 9 to 11 meters. For 9 to 12 centimeters. Then we do second tibia lengthening, usually by 4. For 11 to 13 years. The final one is humeral lengthening at age 15 to 16, usually between 8 to 10 centimeters. Why we do humeral lengthening? Because we want to have proportionate shape of the patient. Why we finish at age 15 to 16 years? Because most of the psychological problems, psychiatric problems, occur during after high school when they go to the university. When you go to college. So we want the patient, with achondroplasia to face the society with a new shape, with a new length. So the people will not say, this guy was short, then he had operations. No, no, no. He will face the society while he's 160 centimeter tall. He's a tall patient, normal patient, proportionate patients. So the self-esteem will be that good, so he can work, he can move in the society in a normal way. And this is an example. This patient presented to us at this age, 18 years old, with the lengthening of the tibia for 17 centimeters. You see how the patient walking and the frame on both sides, in the swimming pool. Then femoral lengthening for 13 centimeters on both sides. You see femoral and tibial lengthening. Then humeral lengthening for 10 centimeters to have proportionate dimensions of the upper and lower limbs. You see how the patient is working on the computer. And this is showing you the steps of such patients. It's very important also for the hygiene to have normal length for arms. Old age. This patient presented to us at age 53. We don't have age limit. This is a very important issue. We don't have an age limit. Because some people think that lengthening for young people and for old people, it's not possible. This is not true. This patient came to us at age 53 years with achondroplasia, with severe knee and ankle deformities, and started to have pain. So we decided to correct it by bifocal corticotomy. You see, we did corticotomy of the upper part and corticotomy of the lower part. We corrected the deformity, we tightened the lateral ligament, and we had some length. As you see here, with gradual stretch at the age of 53. So there is always hope for older people if you want to have lengthening. we don't have a problem with the older people. Lengthening is not only for children. This is not true. Lengthening for all ages. And you see after fixing the movie. Cosmetic lengthening. Cosmetic lengthening is a very important topic. And we believe that everybody has the right to have the normal shape in his point of view. So we lengthen some people who are not really short. We lengthen 180 centimeter guy for specialism. If you are convinced, but you have to know that reality has to be closer to the expectations. You have to take care of this during discussion with the patient. Also, cosmetic lengthening, psychiatric evaluation is mandatory for the patients to exclude body dysmorphia. This is very important to have psychiatric help before giving the patient his chance to have cosmetic lengthening. We almost lengthen 35 to 40% of the people coming to me for cosmetic lengthening. And this is an example for cosmetic teeth and lengthening on both sides for 11 centimeters, as you see. And this is gradual lengthening. And this is the end picture with normal bone formation and normal function. Upper extremity lengthening. The reason upper extremity operations are not attempted as often as lower extremity operations might be due to reports of high rates of complications and the possibility of functional deterioration. Why the upper extremity lengthening is not that widespread? Because there was a bad reputation before. The bad reputation was based upon nothing. People were thinking that if you do upper extremity lengthening, the function will be less. This is not true. The second thing, many of the people who did upper extremity lengthening had very little experience. They were doing one patient per year or something. So how they were going to have an experience? They have very limited number of patients. I looked to the papers when they speak about the lengthening. They spoke about a very small number of patients. What are the indications for upper extremity lengthening? Achondroplasia, hereditary multiple cystosis, physeal growth arrest, a mutation. Some people have a mutation. With a congenital or traumatic infection with septic emphysitis. Shortening from trauma, also trauma can cause shortening. And this is an example of a 12 years old boy with 10 centimeter post-traumatic hemorrhage shortening. You see to the shoulder. People were afraid to do bone lengthening with the humerus because they thought if you do lengthening with the humerus, you are going to have shoulder dysplasia. This is not true. We didn't see any case of shoulder dysplasia in our experience. You see, we get gradual lengthening at the end of distraction, and you see normal shoulder, there is no problem at all. Again, radial club hand. People think that the maximum length you can do is 20% based on an experimental study. This is not true. We lengthened this patient, the forearm of this patient, 115% of the original place. And you see, pharyngeal lengthening is a very important topic. You see, in such patients with congenital deformities, we lengthen two metacarpals at the same time using two small external fixators. Again, this is an amputated stump. We lengthened an amputated stump, as you see here. And this is post-traumatic loss of half of the metacarpal. And we lengthened, as you see, the metacarpal for such a long distance. So we had many cases of pharyngeal lengthening, you see. The magnitude of lengthening, the age of lengthening. There is no age of lengthening. We lengthen the patient at any age. Again, I want to repeat it. Do we have a limit? Do we have a limit? Like the people say in the West, 20%. This is not. This is not. This rule comes from doing very small number of cases by many surgeons in many centers. So we don't have this limit. Look at the case of tibia intermedia or congenital absent tibia type 2. In such a case, the first operation was to move the tibia above the fibula. We did that. Then we did fusion of the lower tibia to the femur. Then we did corticotomy and lengthening. Then we had this lengthening. Then we had another lengthening, like you see here, for such a long, long distance, about 12 centimeters. See, for tibia intermedia. And the function is okay. And you see after such a, before sclerotibial maturity is almost the same length. And in the fifth operation, we corrected the valgus deformity, as you see here. Humeral lengthening. The basics was you don't have to lengthen the humerus for such a long time, otherwise you are going to have shoulder surgery, like this patient. These patients. What you see here, in such a patient we started, this was long, long time ago, we have shortening, we have severe short of 10 centimeters, we did lengthening for 4 centimeters. But the patient continued to have such a long time. The family decided to continue. You see, about 110% lengthening of it, nothing happened to the patient. And so afterwards, my decision was to lengthen the humerus for such any distance. Like such a case, 11 centimeter lengthening of the humerus. So we don't have this restriction. Again, the limit to develop. Do we have a limit? I'll show another example. This is an amputated cusp, which had been treated in the Coptic hospital in Kenya by reimplantation. To have a successful implantation, they removed part of the bone, very long segment. The implantation succeeded, and you had non-union deformity and 22 centimeter shortening for the implantation. So we did. This is showing you the shortening, how far shortening it is, and the deformity. We did corticotomy and debridement of the lower part and compression lower down, the gradual lengthening, 10 centimeter, 15 centimeter, 22 centimeter. So we had level length discrepancy 22 centimeters. You see, this rule is not valid. We can lengthen the distance we want, as you see in such a patient, who is very good. Regenerate formation. The patient is 28 years old. He's not a child. Again, bone lengthening is not only for children. Bone lengthening for any age you want. One important point for bone lengthening: the experience and the role of surgeon volume on patient outcome. The problem which I have been facing now. With medications, that when they read, when you go to the internet, they find papers with certain names. And they think because they publish papers that you have a real experience. This is not true. Animation is not experience. So many people, they show you just animations. Where are the patients? People are showing you cosmetic lengthening. What's cosmetic lengthening? You have a normal leg and they move just like. Where are the rare cases? If you want to do lengthening, you have to find a surgeon with a rare experience, with a rare volume of surgeons. What's the value? What's the volume? The volume is 300 per year, 500 per year, not 5 cases per year. Sometimes we do maybe 5 or 7 cases per day. Where is the problem lies? Where is the problem? The problem lies in the indications. If you look to such indications, in the Western world, it's very limited indications. Why the indications are widespread in Egypt or in the Middle East? Because one third of the population is under age 15. Many of them have congenital deformities with high incidence because of the consanguineous marriage. Consanguineous marriage in some countries is about more than 50% of marriages. High incidence of neglected trauma. In the next 20 years, the number of neglected trauma in the tropical and subtropical area of the low-income countries is far more than high-income countries. Conflicts. This is, we have a large number of patients coming from the conflict zones, and they have shortening and they need lengthening. That's why we have many, many cases for lengthening in this area. And in the West, we have a very small number of cases because of these four factors in such a slide. One third of the population is under age 15. Some countries in Europe, the number of children is getting smaller and smaller, most of the cases. High incidence of neglected trauma, high incidence of congenital deformities, and conflicts. And I think also about experience in which field. Many surgeons are doing cosmetic lengthening. No more. No more. And they do advertisement. They do cosmetic lengthening. Cosmetic lengthening, this is the end of the bone lengthening surgeon. Bone lengthening surgeon. He has to do thousands of cases before going to do cosmetic lengthening. Unfortunately, it's the opposite. If you look at the advertisement, right, just limb lengthening, you find all paid advertisement of centers everywhere doing cosmetic lengthening. Do you call it experience? Do you call cosmetic lengthening only experience? Do you call animation and advertising experience? And as you see again, look to the complication. Look to this review of the papers. The one I want you to recap for you, the number of patients, the period of the study, and how far the experience of each surgeon. Is the surgeon doing 0.2 patient per year or 0.5 patient per year? Look to their experience in pelvic supports. They also speak about 8 cases done in 5 centers by 20. Doctors along 5 years period. So each one of them has an experience 0.1 patient per year. In conclusion, lengthening is a rapidly developing field of orthopedic surgery. Currently, it's a standard procedure with predictable results, and indications have been extended to include upper extremities and cosmetic lengthening too. I think experience has a great impact on the results of different procedures, because follow-up and management of expected complications are cornerstones of treatment strategies. It's very important for the follow-up. It's very, very strange to find people going to have an operation and go back home after 1 week. This is very funny. Experience in the follow-up is far more important than experience in the operations. Even if you do just an aid, so what's the experience in putting an interlocking aid for an orthopedic surgeon? Nothing. Unfortunately, the English literature has many papers with relatively small number of patients operated on by many surgeons over a long period. They have no chance to have real experience. They wrote papers, they wrote many papers, but actually they didn't have the chance to have a real experience in their life. This means that the experience of the individual surgeon is based on only one or few cases per year. Can you imagine? The experience of one or few cases per year, and when you write it on the internet, you'll find his name many times. Sometimes it's difficult to get valid conclusions from the report that makes it better. In spite of the introduction of the promising intramedullary lengthening in ears and computer-assisted external fixation, we still count on the result of biologic laws. Advances through research to simulate regeneration and reduce the period of treatment will be the rare revolution in lengthening surgery. The biological solutions are the rare advances. We are waiting for more research on the biological solutions. So to shorten the period of limb lengthening surgery. Again, if you want to see my opinions after 37 years of experience, after doing thousands of patients of limb lengthening in different aspects, cosmetic lengthening, odontoplasia, post-traumatic, fractures, non-union, femoral hemilia, tibial hemilia, you can find this in my paper in the Journal of Orthopedic and Traumatology, which is in open access. Please read it, and you can find a lot of important facts of limb lengthening. Thank you.